Hello, Frances Seymour. You're the Director General of C4. Can you tell me why you're here at the COP?
Well, if you're concerned about the fate of tropical forests, the UNFCCC is one of the most important policy arenas at the global level that will determine the fate of forests in the future. So I and my organization are here in full force to try to inform the negotiations that are ongoing and use the opportunity to network with colleagues around the world on the state of play.
Okay, so how do you want to inform them? What do you want to inform them of? What do you want them to take away with them?
Well, this week the most important thing is the urgency of getting an agreement on REDD+. It's been 5 years since the idea was first tabled in the context of the UNFCCC. It's been 4 years since the Stern Review made the clear case for the economics of REDD as one of the most cost-effective ways to reduce emissions. Since the Bali COP13, there has been a flourishing of REDD+ initiatives at national, subnational, and local levels. But we really need a global agreement to provide a framework for all these individual initiatives to move forward as quickly as possible. So that's the first message. In addition, though, there is a lot of other knowledge that we have about how to do REDD+ in the right way that we want to make sure is shared. Last Sunday, we hosted Forest Day 4, the fourth in a series of Forest Days in association with the UNFCCC COPs. And at Forest Day 4, we talked about how REDD+ offers an incredible opportunity to meet not just carbon mitigation objectives, but many other objectives as well. For example, conserving biological diversity. Keeping forests as forests is good for the climate, but it's also the best way to conserve biological diversity. REDD+ can be good for other ecosystem services other than carbon sequestration. So, for example, if you're concerned about hydrological services, if you're concerned about pollination services, there are many other ecosystem services that forests provide for free that REDD can help support. A very underappreciated role of forests is in helping local communities and whole societies adapt to climate change. We know that climate change is already in train, and we will be seeing increase in severity and frequency of extreme weather events. You know, the highly concentrated rainfall that causes landslides and flooding in Indonesia, the long droughts and extremely hot weather that causes forest fires in Russia. So intact forests are more resilient to those kinds of disturbances and can help societies overall adapt. And maybe the most interesting and perhaps controversial is that we believe REDD+ can provide incentives to improve forest governance. It's an open secret that forestry sectors are often characterized by high degrees of corruption and elite capture, and we believe that because it's now understood that local communities will have to participate to actually be able to conserve forests, they'll have to be cut in on the deal, so there will have to be a more equitable sharing of benefits. And to the extent that REDD is constrained by unclear land tenure, for example, that's going to have to be sorted out. And investors, whether they're public or private, are not going to invest in REDD+ unless they're sure that the money is going to get to where it's needed rather than be corrupted away. So for all those reasons, REDD+ will provide a powerful incentive to improve forest governance.
So what are the perceived weaknesses of REDD+?
There are a number of perceived weaknesses that have been raised over the last several years. Early on, one of the biggest concerns was that REDD would provide the developed countries with an easy out. Let's put the burden on developing countries to reduce their emissions by protecting their forests, and then those in developed countries wouldn't have to reduce their emissions. But I think everybody understands that in order to stay below a 2 degrees warmer world, it's got to be both and. You can't get there without forests, but you also can't get there without deep emissions cuts from the developed countries. A second concern is that REDD+, if designed poorly, could lead to the kind of alienation of indigenous peoples and local communities from the forest resources that they depend on for their livelihoods and to which they have rights. And, you know, we've seen through history that whenever somebody discovers something valuable in the forest, it's usually the local people who get pushed aside so that a powerful person from a national capital or internationally comes in to reap the profits from that valuable resource. So the question is, why do we think it will be different for forest carbon? And I think there's a real concern that if you commoditize forest carbon, you'll get some of the same negative results that we've gotten from, say, timber as a commodity. I think many people, though, have begun to understand a number of things. First of all, carbon is a different kind of commodity than timber in that you can have revenue flows without destroying the resource. And so we can have all of these other benefits, such as the biodiversity, conservation, ecosystem services, adaptation, and a revenue stream that comes from the carbon sequestration. Also, the current RED negotiations have quite remarkably included explicit focus on so-called safeguards, so that RED investments will be contingent on having done the homework of consulting with local communities to make sure that the social impacts are understood and mitigated, as well as making sure that they're not unintended consequences for biological diversity, for example, by displacing agricultural expansion from a high-carbon, biodiversity-rich area to a low-carbon, biodiversity-rich area, such as a grassland or a savanna, which might be the target for agricultural expansion diverted from forest lands. So I think just over the last few years, we've dramatically increased our understanding about what's necessary for good design of RED to meet those very legitimate concerns.
Okay, and in terms of RED at Cancun, where do you think you're going to be when you come the end of COP16? What is realistic?
Well, certainly what I hear in the corridors is that a comprehensive agreement such as the one that was hoped for in Copenhagen is remaining elusive. And so the best that could be hoped for from the point of view of those who feel that an agreement on RED Plus is urgent is a standalone RED Plus agreement. Many negotiators are talking about RED Plus as a self-contained balanced package in that, you know, in one set of actions, it includes a mitigation mechanism that also includes a financing element, a capacity building element, and the safeguards element and an MRV element all put together so that it's at least possibly separable from a broader comprehensive agreement. I don't know if the negotiators will be able to make it happen, but it's as said by one of our speakers at Forest Day, it's tantalizingly within our grasp. So we're hopeful.
Okay, and if it isn't within your grasp, then you're okay to wait till Durban?
Well, the world is not going to wait for the UNFCCC, and I think this is one of the concerns, is that given the flourishing of RED initiatives that have been kicked off after the Bali Roadmap was agreed to, in a way, the UNFCCC risks being left behind because projects are going forward, national RED Plus strategies and policies are going forward. You know, subnational agreements like the one between California and prospectively Acre and Chiapas states, these things are going forward whether or not there's a global agreement and are beginning to put into place, you know, various standards and norms. And so while it would be a great shame if we missed the opportunity to put into place a RED Plus agreement in Cancun, it's not going to stop RED Plus because all of these initiatives are going to continue to go forward.
Frances Seymour, thank you ever so much for your time.
Thank you.